You, whether you're a guest, member, regular tender, you just came in off the street, okay, we're still glad you're here this morning, okay? Just a quick announcement. Next Sunday is Mother's Day, and I'm going to be doing just nothing profound, just a different message next Sunday morning. This morning, we're going to finish up our second message on post-resurrection, so we'll do that. And then the only thing I really want to announce this morning, you've probably seen this in your email. We touched on it last week, and then this morning as well. We're doing a fundraiser. We're actually in the middle of a fundraiser. We're trying not to overemphasize it, and when we put this together, we wanted to make it something very simple, something easy to do. We're not giving away plastic alligators or balloons or anything like that if you bring anything in as an offering. But what we are asking you to do, we have set a goal. Our finance team and I set a goal of $7,000. Now, this is only an initial goal, okay? I wish we could put a roof on the church for $7,000. But you've probably read the email. We need about $88,000. And so we decided that 7 was the perfect number. So we're praying that the perfect offering comes in that day, all right? Now, if you want to give before this date, you can do that. But we're actually asking you to bring your offerings in on June the 5th, okay? So that's just a few weeks from now. So I'm going to ask you to pray about that, seek the Lord's face, and just really ask Him, you know, what can I do to help? Whether we get a gift of, say, $1,000 or $4, it doesn't matter. But it would be great to see everybody give something toward that goal, okay? So what we're praying for, folks, and what we're doing by faith is this. We're asking God, okay, Lord, you know that we need this roof on the church, and we're taking up this offering. So on June the 5th, we're just praying that $7,000 will come in that day, right? So if you have an offering and you want to give it before that, that's okay. Just make sure you earmark or memo your check roof, okay? But if not, what we'd like for you to do is bring it that Sunday, okay? The one-time offering on Sunday, June the 5th, okay? So if you're not going to be here, you can do it before then or even after if you need to, but that one day, okay? So I want to ask you to be praying about that, right? Be praying about that because the next time it rains, we don't want to get wet in here, okay? All right. Okay, go ahead and stand up if you will. We're going to pray and begin the service. Crystal's going to come lead us in worship this morning. Father, thank you so much for the wonderful ability and privilege of being in your house today. And Lord, as we come to you, we want to ask that you will fill our hearts and our minds and our spirits with your presence, but also, Lord, may we recognize and acknowledge once again how much you love us and how much we love you. And Lord, as we worship this morning, we want to give back an expression of our love to you, Lord, as we lift up our voices to the throne of heaven, God, as we simply acknowledge who you are and who we are. And Lord, I pray over the congregation this morning, whether they're here, whether they're home or watching online, that you will meet the needs of our folks, God. Lord, there are people praying today for health and healing. There are people today, Lord, that are lonely and feel just somewhat as an outlier or outcast. God, there are people today, Lord, that are searching. Some are praying and looking for answers today for things that maybe only they and you know about. But Lord, today as we come, we just simply want to rejoice. Lord, we want to be excited, Lord. And we want to express to you one more time, God, just on this Sunday morning, Lord, the love we have for you. Jesus, we pray in your name. Amen.
King of glory, the King of all kings. Thank you. Thank you.
1992, Whitney Houston sang the number one most popular song, "I Will Always Love You." Anybody know that song? Familiar with it? Okay, a few of you. Well, you know, it's not always easy to express our love towards someone. I'm not sure about you, but I think most people, at one time or another, they find it difficult to express the love they have for someone else. You know, some of the most powerful words that we can speak are the words, "I love you." Those are powerful words, aren't they? They're not words to be thrown around lightly or, you know, just on occasion, throw out there. But the question I want to begin with this morning is, how do you respond to that? When someone says, "I love you," how do you respond to that question? Sometimes it's awkward, isn't it? I mean, let's just admit it this morning. It's awkward sometimes when you want to express your love towards someone or when someone says, "I love you." Especially when you're a grown man and your mom says that. You know, you wonder how you respond. Some of the typical responses are, "I love you too." Then there's the one, you know, "me too." And you wonder, do you love them too, or do you love me too, you know? Do you love yourself too? And if you're a typical guy, you know, guys have a very much harder time expressing love. And sometimes they'll just simply say, "yep," okay? You know, "I love you," "yep," okay? Or send it back in a text, "yep," okay? So you have to kind of take it that yeah, they do too. You kind of have to kind of take it that they're trying to express it in some way or another. Well, one of the top encounters that Jesus had in the New Testament was with a person that he had a conversation with centered around the topic of love. Now, we're going to pick up where we left off last Sunday in John chapter 21. So go ahead and turn there if you will. And, you know, you're going to have to read through some of that. You're probably very familiar with the story. You've heard this at least once, from these scriptures. But this is all post-resurrection. And the disciples had finished, remember, they had fished all night long. They caught nothing until they threw their net on the right side of the boat, like Jesus told them to, and then they hauled in 153 fish. Now, a lot of people like to get, you know, they really love those details, and they want to know, what does the 153 fish mean? Well, there are all kinds of opinions from commentators what the 153 fish mean, okay? First of all, I think you have to understand that fishermen simply counted fish, all right? And if they counted them the same way they weighed them, there might have been more than 153, okay? Because we always weigh them. They don't weigh as much as we say they do. And sometimes we don't catch as much as we say we do, okay? But John records 153 fish. And the whole point of that is this. They brought in more fish than they should have, okay? They brought in actually more fish than that net should have or maybe could have held. So it was just simply evidence that this was a great haul. That's the only reason, really, why John records 153 fish. He's simply wanting to say that it was a great haul of fish, okay? So meanwhile, Jesus prepares a breakfast for his disciples on an open fire, and he invites them to join him in the conversation, and he feeds them bread and fish. Now, this is the third time that Jesus appears to his disciples after the resurrection. Yeah, you may notice in the Bible there's a lot of threes and a lot of sevens and a lot of 40s, okay? Numbers do mean something. So John chapter 21, verse 15, we're going to look at the first time that Jesus poses these questions to Peter in this chapter, okay? This is the first of three times. So when they had finished eating, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me more than these?" "Yes, Lord," he said. "You know that I love you." And Jesus said, "Then feed my sheep," or "my lambs." Okay, some of your translations may say lambs. Okay, now that's pretty simple. You know, the beginning of that conversation, it's not anything, once again, very profound. It's just telling you exactly what happened there. Well, Peter loved Jesus the way a natural man. When we look at love here, Peter loved Jesus at this point, and maybe throughout and up to this point, he loved Jesus the way a natural man would love a good man. Okay? It's kind of like the guys that you hang out with. It's that kind of love. Or maybe the kind of love that a brother has for a brother or a sister or a woman has for a sister. The actual word there, if you like this kind of thing, is the word phileo, okay? Two Greek words there used are agape and phileo, okay? They are different words. They have different meanings. But the point is love, okay? That's the point. And so the type of love that they're talking about here that Peter expresses to Jesus is the kind of love that you have for maybe your BFF, your best friend. Or maybe it's the kind of love that you might have for your peeps, okay? Or your posse, okay? That kind of love. Or brother, or sister. It's a phileo, which we get our English word Philadelphia. We named the state after this word. Philadelphia, the city of brotherly love. It all comes like that, all right? So that's where that comes from, the city of brotherly love. But up until now, Peter's love for Jesus was just on the surface. And his love at this point is negotiable. His love at this point is vulnerable. And at this point, his love is fragile, okay? And we can see that when we look at where we're at right here and you move backward, then you can see that Peter's love for Jesus was that kind of love, all right? Vulnerable, fragile, and also it was negotiable. So can ours be at times, okay? We sometimes say, I love you, God, I love you, Jesus, but there are moments when our love as well could be fragile, vulnerable, and also it can be, you know, like Peter's, it can be negotiable. Well, in this encounter, Jesus is not trying to recruit Peter for a task or a job at this point, all right? The conversation is not about trying to win Peter over. It's not trying to get Peter to do something, okay? The conversation is simply about whether or not Peter loves Jesus. That's what the context and the conversation is about. Do you love me? That's why he asks the question three times, all right? Do you love me? Jesus had absolutely no question whether Peter loved him or not. He wasn't trying to determine whether Peter loved him or not because the Lord knows our hearts, doesn't he? He knew the inside of Peter's heart before he ever asked the question. When you ask someone the question, do you love me? No matter how they respond to that, you typically know, no matter what they say in return, don't you? Generally you do, okay? Or you want to anyway. So what's going on here is that this is an encounter where Jesus is not trying to recruit Peter, but he wants to leave out no guesswork in Peter's mind. You see, Jesus didn't have to worry about guesswork, whether Peter loved him or not. He already knew the answer to that. But Jesus wasn't trying to find out if Peter loved him. He was trying to get Peter to realize that Peter loved Jesus. That's the context. You see, the question wasn't whether Jesus loved Peter. Jesus was trying to get Peter to realize how much he really did love Jesus. Let me ask you a question this morning once again. How do we convince ourselves that we love somebody? I want you to think about that just for a minute. If you were trying to convince somebody how much you love them, how would you do that? Okay, and I'm not looking for a response, okay? But how would you do that? Convince someone that you love them. Would you recite the words, oh, let me count the ways? Okay. One, two, okay. Or maybe you might, you know, oftentimes what we do to express our love to someone, we verbalize that, don't we? I love you, okay? And we do expect some kind of response in return. But don't we often give tokens of some kind to express our love toward other people? You know, we give flowers, we give cards. You know, sometimes we'll give jewelry, right? We go to Hallmark and get something there, a balloon of some kind. And then, you know, there are times too we try to express our love. Oh, by the way, don't give chocolate. Don't ever give chocolate, okay? Don't give chocolate to someone you think that you want to express your love toward them. Don't give them chocolate. Do not do that. All right, but we try to express our love toward people in many different ways using tokens, okay? And I don't want to get into the chocolate thing this morning, okay? The encounter that Jesus is having with Peter, some people call patient questioning. You see, Peter knew where he stood with the Lord at this point. He looks back on his life. And here he is in this conversation, this serious, life-changing conversation with Jesus. And Peter is looking back on his life, all right? And there are several things as we look back and see snapshots of Peter's life that might make him question whether he really does love Jesus or not. Now, let's look at a couple of those things. First of all, Peter was a guy who grossly overreacted to things. I mean, wouldn't you say this morning that cutting off ears is over the top? Okay, well, that's kind of over the top, isn't it? And then when you look at Peter, we also know that Peter was the kind of guy that never thought about what he was going to say before he said it. I mean, he just spewed it out there and it fell wherever it could go, okay? Peter did. And then Peter realized that he had bailed on Jesus three different times. Once in the garden, once among the crowd that was mocking Jesus, and then when he said, I'm just simply going to go fishing. So at this conversation, I want to believe that Peter, these things were going through his mind, that he had bailed on him. And then the embarrassment and maybe even the shame of denying him might have been in Peter's mind. You know, it's simple sometimes, guys, when we look at our lives and we realize that we are sometimes in a situation as well where we could be just like Peter, and we may not openly deny him, but we get an opportunity to express our love for the Lord and we sort of miss it. We can miss it as well. I remember the night that I went on campus at Northwestern Business College. And you know, when you're 18 years old and you go to college and you want to make friends with people that you don't know, you've never seen before. And that night when we, you know, as soon as we got on campus, we unpacked our stuff and eight of us, got into a 1965 Pontiac Bonneville. In case you don't know, back then those cars were about the size of a cruise ship. So you could get eight guys in there easily. And so we piled into this car and we head toward Lima, Ohio, and we're going, they said we're going to go bowling, okay? And so we got to the bowling alley and after we got out of the car, we walked straight into the bowling alley. Instead of going to bowling, get a bowling ball, we went straight to the bar. And so we went to the bar and sat down, and everybody lined up against the bar. You know, one guy up here, and I'm all the way down at the end. And I'm wondering, you know, are we ever going to go bowling? The issue here with me that night was the fact that I had only been a believer for about 18 months. So all this Christian stuff was brand new to me, okay? And at that stage in your life, you want to try to live this out the best you can. You want to try to do everything right and, you know, that sort of thing. But when the bartender came up to the bar and he started asking everybody what they would like to drink and went from one guy down through the rest of them, all seven of them, and asked them what they wanted to drink, every one of them said they wanted some kind of alcoholic beverage to drink. And I kept thinking, man, I'm a brand new believer and here all these guys are getting alcohol and I'm in a spot now and I want to make friends and I'm a new place and I'm away from family, I'm away from home and nobody will ever know. And so he gets down to the end and I hesitate. He's like, what would you like to drink? And I'm thinking about it, and I'm sweating blood and tears. And every one of those guys started looking down like this at me, and they're just waiting to hear my answer. And I'm like, I'll have a Coke. And they're like, they're still looking at me like this. And whatever, after I said that, they still look for a moment and then turn their heads this way. The point is this, you know, that's one point in my life when I remember being in a situation where in my mind, in my heart, I had an opportunity to either go with the crowd or not. It doesn't make me a special person, nor did it win me any badges. But sometimes we find ourselves in these situations, ladies and gentlemen, where we speak up for the Lord or we get to deny the Lord and, you know, just make these stands or these opportunities where we get to fish or cut bait, you might want to say. Well, many people believe that because of their past, and this is what we're looking at this morning with Peter, because of their past, their relationship with the Lord and even the church is better avoided, okay? Better avoided. Now we're in a situation here this morning where Jesus and Peter are having a conversation, and he doesn't ask him the question just once, but twice and three times. And he's not trying to convince Peter of anything. He's trying to get Peter to see how much he loves Jesus. And then we know that in the back of Peter's mind, there were things that happened prior to this that could have caused Peter to think, I'll never be worthy of feeding sheep. Every one of us this morning could look at our lives and say, I'm not worthy of doing this or that or the other of the Lord because of something in our past. It may be like somebody you know, or you know, somebody that you've offended, or somebody who's offended you. You just simply want to avoid them altogether. People will stay out of church sometimes, not because they don't want to go, but because they believe that somehow in their life reflects some unforgivable and unrepairable problem. And so they just simply avoid it altogether. Now, I don't know how many people you talk to, but I've talked to several people who say, you know, I'd love to go to church, but there's something in my life that I just don't feel like I could ever go in there again. I don't feel like I'd ever face the Lord again. And they look at their life and they feel like there's something in their life that would cause them or keep them from ever being all or anything that God would ever want them to be. And Jesus in this conversation is trying to move Peter to a place where he's going to serve him once again in spite of the things that Peter had done or experienced in his past. You see, when we come to God honestly with an honest heart and want to get things right with him, we begin the process of resurrecting the relationship with him. Now let's look at the next thing this morning. Let's look at the next verse. Again, Jesus said, Simon, son of John, do you believe me? Now we have to understand once again that Jesus wasn't trying to convince himself of where Peter was. He was trying to get Peter to be convinced, hey, you know what, Lord, I really do love you. I've made some serious mistakes in the past. I've really messed things up here and there. I might have even led some others astray. Simon, son of John, do you love me? And he answered, yes, Lord. You know that I love you. And Jesus said, take care of my sheep. Now, I believe when Peter said, Lord, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. I believe that Peter knew that the Lord knew that in his heart he really did love Jesus. But Jesus was trying to bring him to a place where he really believed that he did, and that his love for Christ would override all of those mistakes that he had made in the past. You see, the question on the table this morning is this, is do you love me? That's the question on the table this morning. And there are two things that I want to point out here. Number one is this, is that love changes everything. I want you to notice something here. And the thing that I'm going to point out that I want you to notice is something that Jesus never did with someone, okay? And that is this. He never brought up Peter's past. Never brought it up. I wonder how many of us, and probably all of us, at some point in our lives, someone has brought up something from our past. You know, especially in those moments when maybe we're trying to reconcile or gifts or do something right or live the right way or whatever it might be, and someone simply reminds us of some way that we messed up in the past. Well, before we go too far with that, we understand this morning from the context of this that Jesus is saying, look, Peter, it doesn't matter what's happened in your past. I'm trying to bring you into your future. And it didn't matter what Peter had done in the past, Jesus was bringing him in, showing him this agape love to where that love superseded and transcended all the mistakes that Peter had ever made. And you know what, guys? It's not just Peter's life. When I read this story numerous times, it reminds me of how much God's grace and mercy overrides those things where we just simply fall short of. I remember seeing this, and I wasn't at the funeral myself, but I saw a video clip of Dr. Billy Graham's funeral, and one of his daughters told the story when they were talking about their dad, and some of the things they remembered about him is talking about her dad and the story of when she married a man that her father just simply thought was the wrong person for her. He didn't try to stop her from marrying that guy, but he just simply thought and told her that this is just not the right man for you. But she went ahead and married the guy anyway. And 5 days after that marriage, she walked away from the marriage and went back home. And when she got back home, she said, I remember when I got back home that my dad welcomed me with loving, open arms and embraced me as his daughter and never brought up the fact that I had married the wrong man. She said he never brought it up that I married the wrong man. Never mentioned it again, even though that was a failed marriage. Never brought it up again. You see, Peter must have thought this. Let's look at his life a little bit. We know he's the guy that always gets tagged. He's the guy that always gets picked on for making these huge blunders and mistakes. But Peter must have thought, you know what? I've really blown this. And I want you to try to imagine with me when he's in that conversation with Jesus by the fireside. He just recently said, I'm going to go fishing. Remember last week when not only when Peter said, I'm going to go fishing, but he was so influential that six of the other disciples went with him. Remember that? And so it's like, wow, wait a minute. Now we're in this conversation and you're asking me, do I love you? Do I love you, Lord? And I believe that Peter never felt this condemnation kind of thing coming from those questions. I believe he's progressing and realizing, beginning to realize how much he does love the Lord and how much the Lord really does love him. And so as we look back on that, Peter, he must have thought, man, I've really blown this. Lord, I would never be worthy of feeding sheep ever again. And I don't know about you this morning, but there's times in my own life when I look at my life and I'm like, you know what, Lord, how am I worthy to do these things? How am I worthy, Lord, to stand before people and preach the gospel? How am I worthy, God, of being able to lead a person to Christ and into his kingdom? How am I worthy of that? don't know if you've ever asked yourself that question or not, but I have more than once. And so Jesus wanted Peter to embrace his future. And the only way that Peter was ever going to embrace his future was to stop defining himself by his past. That's the only way he was going to do that. And so part of this conversation is not just to get Peter to see how much he really loves Jesus, but it's to move him beyond his past into his future so that he can be useful once again in the kingdom's work. You know, guys, it doesn't matter how much or how often we feel like we've messed up. The Lord always forgives those things and always has a place for us in his kingdom's service. Always. You look at your life this morning. Those of you on Facebook, you may be watching today and you may think, man, there's been times in my life like Peter that I've really blown it too. You may be in a situation right now where you're like, I've not blown it. I'm actually blowing it right now. And the Lord wants to reach out to you this morning through his Spirit and say, look, you may feel like you've blown it, but I'm trying to bring you into a relationship with me or bring you back into a relationship with me. That's what he's trying to do today. And so as we look back at this story, I want to say this to everybody today, those of you watching me on Facebook as well, that the enemy will sometimes put your life in a holding pattern when you are simply focused on nothing but your junk. Put your life in a holding pattern. One of the places the enemy would love for you to do is put yourself in neutral and not do anything. Not serve, not give, not pray, not read, not go. Just put yourself in neutral. Have you ever thought about this? What if Jesus had not had that conversation with Peter? Where would he have gone? What would have happened to Peter had that conversation not took place? You ever think about that? That's something to ponder. And so this is not just a conversation at a fireside. This has a deeper meaning than that. Let's go back to this just for a minute because there's a progression of love that takes place here. But I don't want to do these Greek gymnastics this morning, you know, with agape and phileo, and I want to stick to the context. You know, most of you by now, you know the four Greek words, you know, agape, phileo, eros, and also storge. You know, you know those words. You've heard them before. But the context really doesn't focus on the meaning of those words. The context focuses on the fact that Jesus is moving Peter through a progression of love that's not hidden in our English language by Greek words. You see, the point is that Jesus was giving Peter a threefold opportunity to restore himself and undo what Peter had already done. A threefold opportunity. One, two, three. Three times he asks him, do you love me? And he's giving him that opportunity three times to undo the things that Peter had done. Isn't it amazing sometimes that God doesn't just come to us just one time and say, you got this one chance, this one opportunity, that he will continue to pursue you and go after you until he brings you back or you reject him? I think that's amazing. And so he was giving him that threefold opportunity. And even though those words have different meanings and they're very important, they really have nothing to do with the context here, because the point is this, that Jesus was giving him an opportunity to undo what, or to restore what he had undone. You see, the love of God, which is something we've heard about so much, we find it so elementary sometimes when we talk about the love of God. But it's far more than something elementary. The love of God goes deep and wide. And I don't think that the human mind can totally fathom and comprehend the love of God. We can understand it through words and definitions. We can understand it through meanings and illustrations. But I don't think we can totally understand the love of God. You see, the love of God, the love that God has for us, is a love that wants to draw us deeper and closer all the time, no matter how far we may have drifted away, and that's where Peter was. Listen today, guys. God's love is constant. God's love is unchanging, and God's love has no boundaries. And I think that's three things that we see here in this conversation with Peter. That God's love is constant. He always loved Peter. God's love is unchanging. You see, God doesn't love one more than the other. God doesn't love us at one stage in our life more than He does at another stage in our life. And God's love has no boundaries. Absolutely no boundaries whatsoever. We sometimes put boundaries on our love. Sometimes, don't you feel like some people, hopefully no one in the room, hopefully nobody on Facebook, but sometimes we express our love based on what others have done for us. Don't we? We sometimes base our love on how good someone else is to us. Or how well they treat us. God's love has no boundaries. Has no socioeconomic boundaries. No race boundaries. Man, what a great thing. And even has no damage boundaries. There's been moments in my life when I have felt damaged. Sometimes self-inflicted damage. You know, I can be a little OCD. Anybody else in here OCD? Every week I go to the grocery store with my wife, Rebecca. Every single week, unless I'm sick, I'll go to the grocery store with my wife, Rebecca. I love going and helping her get groceries. Yeah, I actually do. Some of you don't believe that. I love going to the store and helping her get groceries. I love helping her bag the groceries. I love helping her load them up in the car, bring them back in the house, and I love helping her eat the groceries. Whenever I'm going to the grocery store, there are times when we'll buy a few canned goods, and I'll pick up a can sometimes, and I won't notice it until I put it in the cart. But sometimes the can has a dent in it. You ever pick up a can that has a dent in it? Well, whenever I pick up a can with a dent in it, I always put it back on the shelf. And for some reason, in my mind, psychologically, I'm thinking if that can has a dent in it, there's something wrong with those beans. And we know that if we open up the can, even if it has a dent in it, the beans in the dented can are going to be the same beans in the non-dented can, right? The dent has nothing to do with the beans. Ideal pork and beans. You see, when God looks at our lives, His love for us is the same for the damaged as the undamaged. There's no boundaries there. We know that there could definitely be things where Peter's life could have been tagged as damaged. Tagged as damaged goods. The other disciples may have looked at him at some time and they may have said, you know what, you know, I may not be perfect, but I'm sure not like Peter. Okay? But this conversation shows me how much the Lord Jesus loved Peter, damaged or not. Damaged or not. Perfect or not. Close or not. You see, the love of God never changes. It never changes. Peter, though he was damaged goods, Jesus was trying to draw him into a deeper and deeper and deeper relationship with him to prepare him for what he had next going out. Let's look at the third one, the last one, the third time. The third time he said to him, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Well, Peter was hurt because he asked him the third time. In other words, I've already told you twice. Didn't you get it? Didn't you hear me? Okay. He said, do you love me? He said, Lord, you know all things, and God sure does. You know that I love you. And Jesus said, feed my sheep. Now, once again, the words here are phileo, agape, the God kind of love and the brotherly kind of love. We know those are the words that are used here. But Jesus is drawing Peter into this opportunity to undo what had been done and to really not show him how much he loved him, but for Peter to really get a grip on how much he loved Jesus in spite of being damaged goods, in spite of having dents and dings in his life, in spite of walking away, in spite of being ashamed, in spite of literally denying him, Jesus wanted Peter to see that you really do love me. And listen, folks, let me say this one more time. Do not let the enemy rob you of the fact that you may love the Lord no matter what your past may look like. You see, this was about Peter learning not how much Jesus loved him, but how much Peter loved Jesus. And so for the third time, feed my lambs, feed my sheep, feed my sheep. In other words, Peter, I'm sending you out. There's absolutely nothing from your past, nothing from this conversation, and nothing that I see or feel in my heart that's going to stop me from using you in the future. And I want you to go out now. It's time to go out. I'm going to ascend back to heaven. It's time for you to go out. I'm sending you out. And so what we get out of this morning is just to spend it out, guys. No matter what you have done in the past, the Lord forgives you, brings you back in, and says, listen, I want to send you out, spend it out there. Remember, I said earlier in this message that there are a lot of people that just simply walk away from the Lord, not because they don't love him. They walk away from the church, not because they don't want to be there, but they simply walk away because they feel like there's things in their life that makes them damaged goods, and they just simply would rather avoid it than to face it. You see, this whole conversation here is not about proving that he loved the Lord. It was about restoring that love. And listen to me now. Love flows out from the heart. You see, no matter what has happened in our lives, no matter where we might find ourselves, when we believe and realize that we really do love the Lord, that love flows out of that heart. And we send it out. So I want to encourage you with something this morning. I want to encourage you to return if you need to, just like Peter. To start praying again. You see, the enemy can rob us. Oswald Chambers says the most difficult part of ministry is to pray. And the enemy will do everything he can to rob us of the privilege of praying. To return to praying. Yeah. To return once again. Go back to church. Okay? Go back to church. There's nothing magical about attending a church service. But there is something powerful about it. There's something different about attending a church service with fellow believers than there is simply watching on Facebook. And I know that's all some people can do. And especially not going at all. Return once again to reading your Bible. Return once again. Be encouraged this morning that no matter what our lives might look like, the Lord is constantly drawing us and bringing us back into a deeper and deeper relationship with him. Deeper and deeper. Like Peter, sometimes things get in the way. We walk away sometimes. We deny. We let our own baggage sometimes keep us from doing that. But the Lord this morning, our message this morning, is restoration after resurrection. After resurrection, now what? Return. Restore. Get back. Go out. And love the Lord more than you've ever loved him before in your life. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for the illustration you give us in this conversation with Peter that shows us, Lord, a man's life who maybe looked at it as damaged goods, but Lord, you bring this one man, the one who may have been seen as the most damaged, you bring him back into a restored relationship in this short conversation with three questions. You give him a chance to undo, Lord, what he did. You give us that every single day. And now during this time of commitment, Lord, I pray that each one of us would just simply renew and refresh our commitment to you. Let you restore those things, Lord, that are broken. Bring life back to those dead places, Lord, that we talked about last week. Father, that we may live the life, Lord, that you died to give us, that abundant, agape life that you so desire for us to experience. Help us, Lord, to spend it out, to watch for opportunities, to be cognizant, Lord, and to recognize conversations sometimes that can lead us to a place of helping others find you and your kingdom. Help us as a church, Lord, to continue to rekindle week after week that fire, Lord, of revitalization. Lord, I pray that you'd be with those who are not here this morning for whatever reason. Lord, that you would touch their hearts and, Lord, just softly and tenderly draw them back to you or into a deeper place with you this morning. Lord, for those watching on Facebook, they're faceless to us today. We can't see them. But I pray each week that you would speak to them, Lord, especially those who just simply would love to get out and can't. Now, Father, it's always about responding. Peter had to respond. And he did. And he became one of the leaders and the pillars of the church after all that. So help us to be the same thing. And I pray in Jesus' name, amen. All right, let's stand.
As I am, we're without.
good words. All right. Well, listen, guys, may God bless you. Thank you for being here today. Welcome each other as you leave this afternoon. And whatever you're doing, just enjoy it, okay? Have a good day. All right? God bless you. Yeah.